I'm Kyle Marsh of the Identity and Network Access Group here at Microsoft. In this video, I want to talk about token customization. So the first thing is, why would you customize a token? Well, generally, there sometimes is a need to get additional information into your token, things like our optional claims or maybe group or role information, so that you can have a finer level of granularity to the authorization decisions in your application. Maybe you have specific functionality for, say, an invoice approver or for an admin of the application within your application. So you may want to make those decisions based on more than just the current information that's available in a token. Now, in much the same way as we have an application registration where a developer can do something that would work across tenants, and we have our enterprise app or service principle, where an IT pro can control how a particular application runs within the confines of a particular tenant, we have two different places where you could do your token customization. One is in the application registration. We have a token configuration area where you can ask to include optional claims. These will work for any tenant. So if you were developing, for example, a multi-tenant application, you can always ask for these optional claims, and as long as we have the data, we'll go ahead and populate that claim for you. On the enterprise app, we can also do claims mapping, where you can use specific information about the tenant. So for example, let's say that your enterprise is syncing the division name from on-premise Active Directory through Azure AD Connect to your Azure AD as maybe extension attribute 8. Well, you can create a claim for division name and tell it to be populated from extension attribute 8, which is fine for your particular tenant, but probably won't work in any other tenant. So if you need tenant-specific customizations, you can do that with claims mapping off of the enterprise application or service principle, and for generic token customization, you can do that on the app registration. So remember, there are two primary types of tokens. An ID token is issued to an application. So if I'm an application developer who's signing in a user, I would customize my ID token. Access tokens allow an application access to a resource. If I'm creating a resource or an API, then I can customize the access tokens that I receive from the various clients. What doesn't work is for a client developer who's getting an access token to an API to say, well, I'm going to customize my access tokens. But that doesn't work. You don't change the token because that token belongs to the API developer, and the API developer creates any customization they need as part of the API's app registration. So let's take a look at how we can use this information in our tokens. Actually, I want to start with one demo before this. So I'm here in my enterprise apps blade, and I'm on my best practices application that we're going to use for this demo. I'm going to do something here by going to the properties of the application and say that user assignment is required in order to sign into this application. I've now created a control point that I don't, as an IT pro, need to talk to the developer about. If I come here to my users and groups, let me go ahead and save that. And then I'll go over to my users and groups and see that Kyle Marsh has already been, is here. I can, if I wanted to, come and edit this user, but see that I'll go ahead here and actually assign Kyle because he was using the application before, but he wasn't assigned. So let me go ahead and assign that user to the application. Actually, it says it was already there, so that's fine. So I have my user assigned here. Now if I were to go in and go to my, let's go to, go back to our regular user, and I'll sign out of this application, and I'll sign back in again, but this time I'll pick our friend Moses, who we used in a previous demo, and I'll sign in here. And we'll see that Moses is going to be prevented from signing into this application because he's not assigned. Okay, great. So I did that without actually even having to talk to the developer. And it's the first tier of authorization, if you will, that can be done entirely with the prevention of issuing tokens to an application. So let's go back, and now we will sign in as Kyle, who was assigned to the application, and we'll see Kyle can sign in. And these are the claims that are in the standard ID token whenever we have a user authenticate. So there's our token lifespan. It was issued by Azure Active Directory. The audience is my application ID. So everything checks out here. So great, let's sign out of there and come into the application registration now for the best practices app. And we'll go to token configuration. So now I can add optional claims. First off, I need to say which of the token types I'm doing. I'm an application, so I modify or customize my ID token. If I was an API, I'd modify or customize, rather, my access token. So here is a list of optional claims that are available across any tenant for your application. So let's pick account type, authentication time. Let's go ahead here for on-premise identifier as well. Obviously, any of these are fine to pick up. I'll go ahead and add that. Now, we also have a special ability just around claims, because with claims, things can get a little bit more complicated. So we have different capabilities here that we can do around groups. So groups, I could ask for all the security groups that a user is a member of, or I could ask for their Azure roles that have been assigned, the Azure Active Directory roles. So is this a user administrator, et cetera, so I can get their directory roles. I can get either of those or both. Or I could say I want all groups. That would include those security groups and the Azure roles that I've been assigned, directory roles I've been assigned, as well as any groups that are coming from Office or Microsoft 365, so distribution list, et cetera. So let's go ahead and pick that. Now, when I pick that, that's going to include groups that I'm a top-level member of, as well as any groups that I'm a level of because the group is nested because it's come from on-premise. So let me take a look also. I have another option here that I should point out. I can actually ask for these group IDs to be replaced, rather, with the group name if and only if the groups have been synced from on-premise. So if I'm porting an application from an on-premise and it's looking for the group name, I can do the same thing for that application when it's running against Azure AD. If, when it's an on-premise group, I simply pick the format of the group identifier it's looking for based on what it was doing before on-premise. And that could be that it's looking for the security identifier or the name in one of these formats. I can also emit those renamed group names instead of ID as role claims instead. Again, trying to match what the application might have been encountering in the on-premise world. Since I'm actually working in a cloud-only tenant right now, I'm obviously going to leave it for group IDs, and I won't make that change. So let's pop over to our application now, make sure we're signed out, and go ahead and sign in the user. Now, this application is specifically signing out every time. That's why I can see the claims changing. I'm kind of breaking a rule here and throwing out a perfectly good token I should have cached. In any case, we can see here that I have the type of account this user has, so 0 means a member. I saw when the user last authenticated on this device, which notices actually before the token was issued. So we're seeing single sign-on in effect, if you will, the last time I did a full authentication here. Here's all the group claims that I asked for. So this is any group I'm a member of, including nested groups. And then finally down here, I have my WIDS claims, which show me the WIDS claims, which tell me what directory roles this user has in Azure itself, as in the Azure directory. So that's great. I can do that customization. But notice there was quite a few group claims there, and that can sometimes be a problem. So we have a situation where security groups are very, very handy because I can define a group once, and then I can tell every application, hey, check to see if the user is a member of this group, and if they are, use this authorization or allow the user to have these kinds of things. So it makes it very easy for me as an IT pro. I don't have to keep assigning the group to lots of necessarily to lots of applications. I can simply tell them to go ahead and look for that identifier, or I can assign, obviously, the group to the application if I want. So they can be a very handy construct. Unfortunately, we can't let tokens grow to any arbitrary size. So we have to limit the number of groups, those group IDs that we can put into a group, into a token rather. And the limit is actually, it sounds large, but in practice it's not particularly large. So as soon as a user is a member of more than 200 groups, we can't fit all that in a token. We'll put something in the token instead that tells you, you have to go call Microsoft Graph to get the user's group membership. If it's a XAML token, it's only 150. And if I was actually using implicit flow, maybe part of the hybrid flow for a web app, the limit is actually only 6. So as a developer, I can ask for groups in my token. But if I ask for groups in my token, I must implement Microsoft Graph so that in this situation where I'm told, sorry, the user is a member of too many groups to put in your token, I have my Microsoft Graph code to fall back on to get all of that user's group membership information. And remember, for that, my application will need groupmember.read.all as a delegated permission that does require admin consent. So if I'm doing a regular token, then what I'll see here is instead of a group claim, there is no group claim in this token. Instead, there's an underscore claim, underscore names claim, and one of the values within that array are groups. Now, that is technically telling me to go where to look for the information that I can use to get the groups, but really, all I really need to know is the existence of this groups within the underscore group claim, underscore names claim. Then I know to call Microsoft Graph. I don't need to come and look at this particular query string, which technically is actually talking to Azure AD Graph, so we wouldn't want to use that anyway. But I now know what the existence of the claim names group claim that I am going to have to go and fall back to Microsoft Graph. If I'm using that implicit flow, because of the way that that token is returned on the redirect URL, it has to be smaller. So instead there, we actually limit it to 6, and it's simply the existence of a has groups claim. If there's a has group claim in your token, then you have to fall back to Microsoft Graph. So the logic is look for either the underscore group underscore names claim underscore names claim or the has groups claim. If they're there, go and call the Microsoft Graph API that will get you all of the groups this user is a member of, including any groups that he's a member of because of nested groups. So, and it does require that admin consent privilege. Now, as an option, we could use app roles instead. So let's go back to our demo application here. And we've already signed out of here, so let's go back to our app registration. And here, I'll go to app roles. So let's say I want to have a role specifically for people who can approve an invoice. So I will create an invoice approver role, sorry. I have an invoice approver role. This means I'm going to assign it to users and groups. So that means that by a UI or with the Microsoft Graph API, I can attach this role to a user or group as assigned to the application. Now the value here is what my developer is going to look for in the roles claim that they're going to get back. So no spaces allowed here. And this is just a way to describe this to the users and admins so they know what this role can do. In this case, the user can approve invoices. Okay, so I defined that new role. Now, I can't stop there. I've created effectively an elevated role. These people can approve something. I must create, if I'm going to use application roles, a baseline role. So here I'll just create a user that's assignable to users and groups. The value will be user. And this is a regular user of the app. Okay, so now I've created two roles. One that has a misspelling in it, it says the user is just a regular user, has no elevated privileges. And the other one says this user has an elevated privilege. If I only define the elevated privilege, when I go back, which we'll do right now, I'm going to come back here and modify my assignment here. And let's go ahead and add a new assignment for our finance group. Oop, you know what I should have done? I should have. Well, let's see. So let's wait here. I'm going to go back and refresh. So I have to refresh and wait for let's go back here now to users and groups and refresh this. I have to wait for the replication here as well. So let's go and add our group now. We're going to add finance. And we'll select that one. And now I have to assign a role. I can't not assign a role. Notice if I don't pick this, let me cancel out of there. This button is disabled. I must assign a role. If I haven't defined the base role, then everybody gets the elevated role, and that's not going to work. So I'll go ahead and say that people in finance can be administrators. Oops, I didn't mean to go there. Let me see if I can edit my role here. And see that I can, a regular user, Kyle's a regular user, so I'll assign Kyle the regular user role, so we can go ahead and proceed from there. So now let me go ahead and go back to our application. We've signed out. We'll go ahead and sign in. We might need to wait for a moment or two more for replication, but let's go ahead and see if we can do this. Do I still have my groups claim because I haven't taken that out? Oh, I should show you something, one other thing. Here's my role claim, by the way. There it's assigned because Kyle is a member of the finance group. So that worked. I do want to show you one other capability here, though. If we go back to our application registration, let's go to our token configuration and delete the groups claim that we added, and instead ask for the groups claim to come, but only for groups that are assigned to the application. So now we will put the group ID into the token if the user is a member of the group and the group has been assigned to the application. So this is another way to avoid getting into the token overage situation, because I may not have 200 groups assigned to the application, whereas I might be a member of hundreds and hundreds. So this is another way to help avoid that group overage, and it helps focus. I'm only looking at groups if they've already been assigned to the application. So now if I go back to my application and sign in again, we should see that I'm only going to have one group, which is the finance group, which I am a member of. And because I'm a member of the finance group, then I do get that roles claim as well. So there are a number of ways that you can customize your token. You can ask for optional claims. You can ask for claims that are specific to a tenant through claims mapping. Remember, if you do ask for groups in your token, you must have the Microsoft Graph code to find out what the user's group membership is, because there are situations where the group will be a member of too many group, or the user will be a member of too many groups for us to put in your token. And finally, one other option instead of using groups is to assign roles, which then the IT pros can assign groups and users to the roles that you've created, and that's another way to go as opposed to using group membership for authorization. Thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your day.